By-election looks set to send another SNP MP to Westminster and reduce still further John Major's already slender majority. Good evening from this Perth and Kinross by-election special. We'll soon know whether the SNP have chalked up another historic by-election victory. They're well into the count at Perth City Halls, and already the nationalist troops are massing outside in the streets of Perth, preparing for a runaway vote. The Conservatives are fighting hard to avoid relegation to third place and echoes of Eastleigh. Here, though, in a version of that now famous phrase, it's the Constitution, stupid. In this constituency, once a Tory citadel, it seems voters haven't bought into John Major's vision of a Scotland at the heart of the Union. This by-election was caused by the death of the flamboyant Tory, Sir Nicholas Fairbairn, who'd represented the constituency for over 20 years. At the 1992 general election, he was returned with a majority of 2,000. Snapping at his heels was the SNP's Roseanna Cunningham, who, it seems, barring divine intervention, will tonight become the honourable member for Perth and Kinross. The share of the vote in 1992 was Conservative at 40%, SNP 36%, Labour 12%, and the Liberal Democrats at 11%. But in the most recent electoral test, last month's local elections, the Tories were thumped. Their vote slumped to 23%, that was down 17%. The SNP took control of the council, but their share of the vote barely moved. Labour put on 7%. Tonight we'll bring you the result live, interviews from the count with the winner and losers, jubilation and desperation from our politicians, and cool-headed analysis from Bill Bush of the BBC's political unit. First though, for the latest, let's go over to our political editor Brian Taylor inside Perth City Halls.
Kirsty, thanks very much indeed. The big story here tonight is that the Nationalists could be heading for a majority of 7,000 plus in a seat which, as you said, was once a Conservative stronghold. There are nine candidates in all here. We should know the result in about a quarter of an hour's time. But the big focus tonight, of course, is going to be upon Roseanna Cunningham, the SNP candidate who fought this seat at the general election, running Sir Nicky Fairbairn fairly close. Tonight, she looks like becoming the MP and perhaps sending shockwaves through Scottish and indeed British politics. The second question mark tonight will hang over John Godfrey, the Conservative candidate. Can he hang on even to second place, or will he have to suffer the ignominy of third for the Conservative Party? Mr. Godfrey's fought a good campaign in many respects. He's fought a campaign purely upon the Union. We'll have to see whether the Conservatives will be prepared to answer the question marks over that, should he lose. Douglas Alexander, of course, also the Labour candidate, he faces some question marks as well. Will Labour, who were looking to do well in this constituency, indeed they said at one point of their leaflet they were set to win, will they take second place or third? Will the Tony Blair effect have any impact upon rural Perthshire and Perth City? Well, of course, not all the excitement is inside the hall. There's excitement outside with the massed troops, mainly, it has to be said, of the SNP. Alan Mackay is keeping an eye on that.
There is a buoyant atmosphere out here, and as you can see, there's nationalists here, not just from Scotland, but from Wales as well. These are the people, many of them, the party workers, who've been in the constituency for the last 3 weeks, achieving that 7,000 majority, if that's what it eventually turns out to be. There are, of course, supporters from the other parties here, but I think it's fair to say most of them are inside the shelter of their hall. And with the serried ranks of nationalists out here in this kind of mood, from their point of view, that's probably quite wise. Kirsty.
Well, Brian Taylor has hardly moved from the constituency in weeks as he's followed every twist and turn of the campaign. One thing is for sure, Sir Nicholas Fairbairn will be a hard act to follow. He'd already announced he was going to retire and the candidate John Godfrey was in place. But before his death, Sir Nicky was day and daily distancing himself from his Prime Minister and his party. Whatever his politics, he was always one for the centre stage. Playing in Perth tonight...
I hardly think my decision to retire from Parliament and not to stand for re-election could be described as attention-seeking.
And in doing so, you are cutting off your nose despite your face.
My... bear to rub shoulders in the government side of the house with a lot of little grey clones or the Prime Minister. Ghastly shower voice.
Rubbish!
On the Edinburgh stage, a drunken, lecherous caricature of Sir Nicholas Fairbairn voices his disgust with present-day politics and party. Before he died, Sir Nicholas similarly scorned Parliament and Prime Minister. The Fairbairn funeral, a Gothic event choreographed to Sir Nicky's own design, reflected the former MP's eccentric flamboyance. Controversial to the last, his legacy to his successor was to lampoon him as a party clone. But this insult wasn't the issue, nor was the candidate. The by-election issue was the Tory strategy.
Day one of our campaign, and we're working hard to keep the United Kingdom together.
It was a challenge the Nationalists were happy to pick up.
Clearly, people in this constituency know very well what the SNP stands for, and they know that a vote for the SNP is a vote for a party which believes in an independent government of Scotland.
In this by-election, Perth has witnessed a battle of the flags, with the Conservatives draping themselves in the standard of the Union, while the Nationalists peddled the alternative appeal of the Scottish saltire. The surrounding area is saturated with battle history. From Methven Castle spreads the plain, where the English defeated Robert the Bruce in 1306. Perthshire's setting on the border between highlands and lowlands brought conflict of every kind, from a bloody clan battle which left but a single warrior standing, to the struggle between Scottish Jacobite insurgents and Unionist government forces. There's constancy in that descendants of Bruce still farm the area, but there's political change. Scottish Tories, the one party resolutely and consistently hostile to the 1707 Union, now base their by-election appeal on sustaining that link between Scotland and England. It was all a lot easier in 1963, when the Scots aristocrat Lord Hume, who had become Prime Minister, required a common seat. Perthshire Conservatives issued a polite invitation, and the voters duly obliged. Political life is much tougher now for Perthshire Tories. Their opponents' appeal to the voters is that the Tory party is no longer Scottish at all. The SNP's Roseanna Cunningham reacts with exaggerated horror on learning that some Perth glass for export has to be marked made in England.
The old engineering handbook.
Does that not annoy you, having to made in England? Yeah. have you even tried made in Britain?
We've tried that, nope.
She's happy to claim that Tories are also English-made. Ms Cunningham brings an intriguing past to Perthshire, a left-wing socialist cheat against the monarchy.
I just think it's the pinnacle of the class system.
Do you think that's a view that's shared by most people in this constituency?
No,
the pinnacle of the class system?
Of course not.
Her Republican views run counter to SNP policy, but earlier there were other problems. The party's president, Winnie Ewing, raked up an old affair with the estranged first husband of her daughter-in-law, Margaret. Ms Cunningham withdrew. After internal manoeuvring, she was tempted back, and for the benefit of voters, the party staged a public reconciliation with her accuser. After the selection turmoil, Ms Cunningham pursued a safety-first campaign, stressing decent mainstream Scottish values. John Godfrey, a Scots-born London banker, tried to shake her, but walked into trouble. The Tories labelled her Republican Rose.
I accused election campaign against Queen and country.
They compared nationalism to the Nazis.
If you look back through history, every country which has gone down the route of extreme nationalism has ended up causing mayhem, war, tragedy, loss of life.
Finally, they urged the disaffected to vote anything but SNP.
Sorry.
I'm not. Don't mind which way you vote, as long as it's not SNP.
Labour went for youth, the football-playing Douglas Alexander, a 27-year-old lawyer and former aide to Gordon Brown.
I think it is quite clear that the Labour Party will defend the interests of the Scottish people as it deems necessary in all circumstances.
Now, quite the cry was New Labour, New Scotland, but journalists complained of Orwellian newspeak, the vacuous soundbite tendency, and there was internal tension. Tony Blair's acolytes demanded to know why party advance in Middle England wasn't entirely matched in Middle Scotland. Scottish officials responded by hyping Labour's prospects while privately cursing four-party politics. More in hope than hype, the Liberal Democrats said the seat ought to be their natural territory. The candidate, Veronica Linklater, proclaimed herself a Perthshire gal who sympathised with the Tory candidate's troubles.
Yes, I do. I do, rather, yes. Pat him on his little head.
It is.
In minor key, the UK Independence Party took to the streets with their anti-Brussels message. And the Greens tried shock tactics to warn the voters. But back with frontline politics right in the middle of the campaign, the Prime Minister arrived at the Scottish Tory conference to confront the party's problems. The big worry for John Major, of course, is the government's general unpopularity. And naturally, Perth and Kinross Tories suffer their share of that. But there's an added dimension. The conference fringe launch of demands for a Home Rule referendum prompted accusations of treachery.
You're a sham, an absolute sham, every one of you. You're a disgrace to the party.
Few Tories back devolution, but far more, including Ian Lang, accept that the party must strengthen its Scottish profile. But what to blame should they lose? Not the candidate, he's coped quite well in difficult circumstances. Most probably they'll say it's a midterm protest rather than rejection of the union. And what of the SNP? Should they win, they'll claim a substantial advance for Scottish independence rather than tactical protest support for the party placed second last time round. In this largely rural seat, the truth lies in the middle. Anti-government protest plus a feeling that Scotland has been neglected. The Nationalists say they stand for Scotland's pride, past and future, but the Tories claim the same ground. Bordering the seat is Scone Palace, where Scotland's kings were crowned. A decade ago, palace guests each planted a tree. Only one survives, that planted by Margaret Thatcher. Scots Tories can only hope their roots are also strong enough to survive.
And now, with Brian at the counter, two of the people who have been joined at the hip to their candidates for the past 3 weeks, the heavies, otherwise known as the campaign managers.
Thanks so much indeed, Kirsty. I'm not quite sure about the heavies, but nevertheless, the campaign managers certainly are with me. Mike Russell, first of all, from the SNP, by common consent, your party looks like winning tonight.
So. I think so.
Do you think it sends a message beyond the shores of Scotland, a message perhaps to the Prime Minister?
Very strong message. I don't think it matters who the Prime Minister is. The Tory party has offended the people of Scotland, it's offended the people of Perth and Kinross, and it is paying a terrible and possibly terminal price.
Terminal? You mean all the seats going in Scotland?
Well, I think there's a very real possibility now that the Tory party is facing a wipeout in Scotland. This was one of its strongest seats. This is really the heartland of the Tories in Scotland, and it can't hold it. And I think that's a very strong message. It doesn't matter who the Prime Minister is. The Tories really are on the ropes.
Raymond Robertson, presumably you accept defeat tonight as a likely prospect?
Yes, it looks very disappointing that we've lost this very tight Conservative SNP marginal seat. And it's very disappointing that we're not going to have John Godfrey this time round as a Member of Parliament. But with a swing that looks like being one of the lowest against the Conservative Party in 5 or 6 years, the SNP really have failed to capture the imagination. With a turnout of just over 6%, really the message from this by-election has been from traditional Conservative supporters is that they're just not willing to vote for us at the moment, but they're not really willing to vote for anybody else
but,
either.
But Mr. Robertson, the Prime Minister himself talked up the union. You made the union the single plank of this campaign. Would you be willing to accept this as evidence of rejection of the union?
Well, when your main opponent is a party which wishes to destroy the union, to go against all that you believe in, then obviously we fight on that. But as I say, the SNP...
But you're not willing to accept the verdict?
The SNP have scored only marginally
incapable
more than they did
of listening
on
to the
April
people
the 6th.
Quite
this is
incapable
no,
of
this
listening
is no
to
endorsement for the SNP. Indeed, one opinion poll only yesterday said that less than half of the nationalists voting today wanted independence. This is a traditional by-election with a swing, as I said, of probably around 11-12%, which is a third of Newbury, less than a third of Christchurch.
Mr. Russell.
Completely bizarre. I mean, Raymond's problem is that he knows he's lost this seat. The next seat that Raymond loses will probably be his own. And it is that total incapacity to listen to what people are saying, to understand the problem. There's an adjuvant. The Tory parties are the lemmings of Scottish politics now.
Very, very briefly, Mr. Robertson, you fought this by-election on the union, and yet you're now going to say it's a protest vote against government economic policy, etc.
We fought this by-election on a whole range of issues. The disappointing thing about this campaign is the fact the SNP would answer none of our questions. Now, over the next 2 years, the new MP for this seat is going to be under the spotlight, and she's going to have to come up with answers she's failed to come up with in the last 3 weeks.
Thank you. Thank you both very much
Incredible.
Indeed for those comments, and with that, I'll hand back to Kirsty in the studio. Kirsty.
Well, here in the studio are the political big guns who've been sounding off around the constituency for the past 3 weeks. The Scottish Office Minister, George Kiner, George Robertson, the Shadow Scottish Secretary, the leader of the Scottish Liberal Democrats, Jim Wallace, and Alex Salmond, the Scottish National Party leader. We'll be hearing from them in a moment. But first, Bill Bush of the BBC's political unit. You heard Raymond Robertson there disparaging the low turnout, but what are the ramifications for the government nonetheless?
Well, more than just another by-election, but mainly because the union has been put right at the centre of it. It's the first time there's been a by-election in Scotland where the SNP have been the challenge party to the Conservatives. So it's new territory. The Conservatives decided to make the union the centrepiece of their campaign. So it's a big issue in Scotland, and they run the risk of it backfiring on them.
At the same time, if history is any measure, any by-election won by the SNP is reverted to type at the general election.
Well, voters seem to be getting more and more volatile. All the SNP gains from Labour went back at the next general election. All the Conservative losses in the last Parliament went back to the party went back to the Tories, away from the party that won them at the by-election. So they'll say, low turnout, by-election protest, we'll get it back.
Now, what should we be looking for in terms of Labour's performance tonight? I mean, very much in the middle of the campaign, they thought they were on a winning ticket. They started to hype the campaign much more. What should we be looking for in terms of their percentage vote if they're to actually measure up?
Elections are often about expectations, and the Labour mistake was to hype expectations. They started in third place. In by-elections, third place parties normally get squeezed. However, they've now made a rod for their own back. So if they don't get past 20%, if they don't get into second place, people will say it's a failure for them.
We'll be looking for that magic 20% from Labour in a few moments. But first, Perthshire is no stranger to political drama. Indeed, the last by-election fought in this area was one of the most extraordinary in recent British political history. Colin Mackay reports on Perthshire's political past.
If anywhere in Scotland qualifies for the epithet Land of the Purple Heather, Land of the Shining River, then this is it, one of the most beautiful counties in Scotland. Its peace and grandeur suggest a tranquil permanency, but that wasn't the case 30 years ago.
The agricultural area of Kinross and West Perthshire provided the political story of the year and possibly the century.
Not since Edwardian times has a Prime Minister sat in the Lords. So when the 14th Earl of Hume succeeded Harold Macmillan as Premier, the new PM had to become an MP. But where to stand for Parliament? A by-election was pending in Kinross and West Perthshire, where the Tory candidate was George Younger. He did the decent thing, he gave up his seat.
The events of 1963 were such an enormously sort of big national event, and for a very young candidate as I was, it was an absolutely gobsmacking experience suddenly to be faced at the age of 31 or whatever it was with the world's press. So it was quite clear to me that as we had a Prime Minister who was just come in strange circumstances, that he had to get into Parliament quickly, and as a Scot, it seemed to me very desirable we should have a Scottish Prime Minister, and I knew that it was the right thing to do.
As Lord Dunglass, Alec Hume had been Neville Chamberlain's assistant at the time of appeasement. The young aristocrat built himself a distinguished career, rising to Foreign Secretary. His search for a common seat proved too much for star of That Was the Week That Was, Willie Rushton, who also stood in the constituency. He won 45 votes. The XL he'd been lampooning easily took the seat.
We cannot rest on our laurels as an imperial power. We cannot...
Despite his bombast, Hume remained Prime Minister for just 1 year, but another 10 as MP, his vote never falling below 50%, a feat that won the admiration of his successor.
He was a very great man, he was a very great Scotsman who made his contribution to British politics. Obviously, people had a personal admiration for him, but when one great man goes, somebody has to succeed him, and it makes one all the more ambitious to do well and to walk tall.
Nicholas Hardwick Fairbairn, top defence lawyer and all-round eccentric, was chosen to replace Hume in 1974. Many thought it improbable that this staid and very conservative constituency would take to such a flamboyant MP, but they did. While Tory seats all over Scotland crashed to the SNP, Fairbairn scraped in with a majority of just 53 over the Nationalist. So began a personal crusade.
You can, will and must win this seat for the Conservative Party, who are the party of all the people. We have wounded the socialist dragon. Go forth today and slay it.
His vote stayed remarkably constant even after the seat changed to Perth and Kinross in 1983. Constant, too, was Nicky's combative style.
And all this nonsense about back to the basics. I mean, is that what you say to your girlfriend on your honeymoon? Listen, darling, I think it's time we got back to basics.
The wedding of Sir Nicholas and his second wife, known to all as Lady Sam, was a thing of wonder, held at the castellated splendour of Fordal, their fortified house in Fife. He became Solicitor General for Scotland, but a few injudicious remarks about a controversial rape case led to his isolation and fall, but his views on women remained unchanged.
Are women some feebleness that they have to be protected? Not at all. They are the tauntresses.
On his death earlier this year, the profusion of obituaries and leading articles went far beyond what one would expect to mark the passing of a Grousemoor backbencher. Between them, the Knight and the Lord were the people's representatives here for a third of a century. A new political chapter opens tonight.
Colin Mackay there, and indeed we are hearing that we're expecting a result within the next 5 or 6 minutes. Just time to have a quick word with the panel here. George Kynock, you had what it would seem would be a central office dream candidate. Supports VAT and fuel, supports rail privatisation, actually even supported the poll tax, but most of all stood four square behind the union and came a cropper.
Well, Kirsty, as you know, general elections are a very different matter from by-elections, and by-elections are exceedingly difficult for governments to win. If we look at the past history of by-elections, I'm afraid it is very difficult to get people to concentrate on policies. It tends to be the focus for protest votes, and I think we have to accept that there's been a significant protest vote tonight. What is very significant is, if the figures are right that are coming to us, that it's a 62% poll, then compared with the general election, some 11,600 voters have stayed at home.
You say it's a protest vote. Can you just explain what they were protesting about?
Well, in the middle of a government term, government policies are always seen by the electorate to be less than popular. But what this government has clearly addressed is the economic situation of the country, and clearly the Prime Minister has been consistent in saying that he was elected for a 5-year term. Don't judge him halfway through. That's the policy that I believe will come up for decision time, which will be at the general election, when, as I say, the 11,600 voters who haven't voted at this particular by-election will be casting their vote, and they'll be casting their vote for a government.
Alex Salmond.
Well, all of this would be very well if the Conservatives had fought the by-election on their government's record. But, of course, the Conservatives said they weren't going to fight on that. They were going to fight on a single issue, that was the maintenance of the union. They wanted to fight the by-election on the SNP's policy of independence in Europe. And the Tory candidate made this by-election a referendum on the union. Now, the question for Joyce Kynock is the one that Raymond Robertson wouldn't answer. Having made a by-election a referendum in the union and lost, are the Tories now going to accept the result?
The union... as John Godfrey said, or is there going to be any listening to the people of Perth and Kinross?
Well, let's just take a look at the opinion polls that have been running around with regard to even the SNP view on independence, their main plank policy. Only 44% in Perth and Kinross of their supporters actually want independence. I think that knocks a hole through the policy issue. Whilst we might have wanted to have the electorate... With respect, Kirsty, whilst we might have all wished to have the electorate address the policies, in a by-election, I'm afraid that they don't. As I repeat, 11,600 people have stayed at home.
But by the same token, that poll showed that a third of Tory supporters want some kind of constitutional change. Now, John Major said very clearly he is going to be the listening Prime Minister. From now on, he is going to listen. Now, surely, if you're saying it's a protest vote, surely there's now some indication that you will revise your position on the Constitution. You made this by-election a referendum on the Constitution. As Alex Salmond said, it was the key issue. John Major wrote John Godfrey a letter and said, you've put the union at the heart of your campaign. That was the right thing to do.
Well done,
in fact, Kirsty, if you looked a little bit further into that opinion poll, you'll find that the Constitution represented only the most important factor for 8% of the people.
Look, you can't have it both ways. I mean, either you're accepting opinion polls, in which case your policy is the least popular in Scotland, or alternatively you're accepting the verdict of the electorate of Perth and Kinross, you're not the most popular
Let's bring in George Robertson.
One or the other.
George Robertson, of course, your candidate, Douglas Alexander, was talking about extremism, either the status quo extremism or the extremism of independence. But it doesn't seem to have served your case terribly well.
Well, it depends on what the result's actually going to be. The fact is that we've been squeezed in a classical
situation here in a by-election. We'd hope for differently. We'd be disappointed not to have done better. But if we're over 20% tonight, then that will almost be a post-war record for a third place candidate to do well. But the fact is that this election has been about one issue. It's a one-issue election, how to get rid of the Tory. And unfortunately, a lot of people were saying to us today, said to me, we're sorry, we're Labour, we support Labour, we want a Labour government, but we want to get rid of the Tory and we're not taking any chances. And I think last week when the SNP mounted a campaign to say, don't take a gamble, a lot of people thought, well, maybe that is the point of view that has got to be taken here. We fought this campaign well from a base of 12.5% at the last general election. And we are in the rural areas of Scotland to stay.
Jim Wallace, in a situation where a by-election is fought on a particular single issue, and that single issue is the union, the fact that your candidate fought on local issues doesn't actually matter a whit, does it? Because you're not seen as distinctive as far as the union's concerned. You may as well vote for Labour.
Well, Custer, you said it, the media all said it was about the union. The Tories wanted to play it up. That opinion poll, which we're now all referring to, said the actual people of Perth and Kinross, and it's time the media, as well as the politicians, listened to the people of Perth and Kinross. They said they were interested in the local issues. And what we have seen is a party that the SNP are taking the protest vote. People want to protest, and for heaven's sake, they've got lots to protest about. And that's precisely what they've done. About half the people who said they were voting SNP didn't support Scottish independence, but they actually saw the SNP as the best vehicle to register their protest against the government. And that means where we're in the position of second place, like Littleborough and Saddleworth, we stand to gain.
Well, right now we must now go over to Alan Mackay, who's with some party activists outside Perth City Halls. Alan.
And the news from inside the hall, first of all, is that we understand Labour and Conservative are very close in the vote. We'll come to that in a moment, but first, Tom Chalmers for the Scottish National Party. You've seen a lot of Roseanna Cunningham's campaign.
Yes,
indeed. She ever nervous or confident throughout?
She'd been confident throughout after the initial media problems over selection, but since then we've been very confident. Despite the personal attacks from other parties, she's been very confident, she's been calm, cool and collected. She's going to be an excellent MP for Perth and Kinross.
Ian Stevenson for the Conservatives. How is John Godfrey going to feel about being the fall guy?
Well, he's going to be very disappointed, obviously, but starting mid-term with a majority of 2,000, our back was always to the wall from the beginning. And he's fought a very positive campaign. He can be proud of the campaign he's fought, and he'll be disappointed, but he'll be back.
No regrets at the way party managers directed the campaign on the constitution?
I don't think it was party managers totally. It was John's decision to do that. But when you have the front runner obviously being SNP, which is Independence for Scotland, as their main platform, then you have to meet that challenge with the direct negative to that, which is the constitutional issue of the union.
Now to Labour, Angus Mackay, you're a close personal friend of Douglas Alexander. Will he regret that Labour said halfway through that they could win?
I think what Douglas will be very proud of is that he and the Labour Party fought a very strong campaign. What we proved is that in Tony Blair's Labour Party, we don't just pick easy fights. We fight everywhere where we can contest elections, and we fight to win. There are no regrets, no apologies. We're here to stay long after this crowd's gone home. Labour will carry on the fight in Perth and Kinross.
Derek Houston for the Liberal Democrats. You've been driving Veronica Linklater around. Does she regret that she appears to have been squeezed out and maybe hasn't got the policies over?
No, I think we avoided the squeeze situation very well, and I think our votes hold it up. I think what Veronica has brought to this by-election is a measure of passion, which I think was perhaps lacking some of the other candidates.
For the moment, gentlemen, thank you. We'll be coming back to you after the result. Now it's back to Brian Taylor inside the City Hall.
Thanks very much indeed, Alan. Well, the situation here is there's squabbling going over, which is delaying the declaration. The squabbling's not over who's first. No one doubts very much that that's going to be Roseanna Cunningham for the SNP. The squabbling is over whether the Conservatives are going to do an Eastleigh, if you like, and come third in this constituency. My understanding is that Labour and the Conservatives are very close indeed. There's John Godfrey, the Conservative candidate, watching rather nervously just in front of the platform to see the outcome. And the Labour Party also keeping a very close eye on the final count and the final scrutiny of the votes. The situation as I understand it is, that's Douglas Alexander indeed, the Labour candidate. The situation as I understand it is that Mr. Alexander and Mr. Godfrey are extremely close indeed, tying for second and third place. And the position at the moment is that the Conservative Party, of course, to whom second place is important now that they can't win, may ask for what's known as a bundle recount, that's a relatively limited recheck of the votes. Hand back now to the studio.
So in fact, we could be delayed for two or three minutes as we go for a bundle recount. Bundle recount would be rather unusual, Alex Salmond, for second and third place.
Simon recount. My understanding is you can get a recount to save your deposit. Mm. And I don't think even the Tories are in that position in Perth and Kinross. So you can get a recount to see who's won. I can't actually remember having a recount to see who's second place. But can I just dispose of one thing about this low poll? Mm-hmm. The parliamentary polls from the last seven by-elections, Dudley West 46.9%, Rotherham 44%, Eastleigh 58%, Barking 38%, Bradford 44%, and Islington 45.6%. This is actually for a by-election, is a very high poll indeed. And so this nonsense from George Kynock from his central office brief about this being a low poll for a by-election is total and utter nonsense.
Yeah, there was a great deal of hype in all the parties around the campaign, and the general election result was 77%, which was a high turnout anyway.
Certainly, but I mean, by-election polls are usually down in general election. But can I give you an example from recent Scottish politics? Glasgow governed in 1988, which I think all of us would agree was a very substantial by-election, had a poll of, I think, if I remember right, 62%, which is going to be around the same, perhaps marginally lower than this. This is not a low poll for a by-election. On recent by-elections, this is a very high poll, showing a substantial interest in the people of Perth and Kinross. And this attempt by George Kynock to disregard a result which he claimed was going to be a referendum, or his party does, on the constitution, and then to sweep it aside on the basis there's been a mass abstention from Tory voters, is total and utter nonsense.
As
the
usual,
Tories have lost
course,
because they lost the argument.
As usual, of course, Kirsty, Alex is very good at being selective with his figures, because I'm going to quote you from the turnouts in recent by-elections in Conservative seats, which are
let's
important.
Let's not trade figures all night.
In fact, they run at 74, 71, 65 and a half, 66 and 76.
But
you know, the long and the short of it, as you rightly pointed out, and I think you really did get to the nub of the problem, is that compared with a general election, there is a difference between 62 and 77% of some 11,600 voters.
But
it is more than likely that these are Conservative
but
voters.
If the 11,000 people that stayed at home are watching tonight, wouldn't they think that that is a rather lightweight dismissal of what obviously are very serious problems for Conservative voters who feel they can't turn out for you?
I am not saying anything other than the fact that it's a great disappointment, but in by-elections, when people are very well aware that it is not critical to a change of government, then in fact they feel that
but it
rather
is critical
than
to this slender
party,
majority at the
well,
moment, isn't
with,
it?
With respect, the important thing here is, and here we're hearing that how close second and third are between Conservative and Labour, in a seat that the Labour Party have consistently said the whole way along, and Tony Blair has visited twice, and George Robertson has said they can win, that they're now fighting as to whether they might be third.
The fact, George, is that no matter whether or not you get 20% tonight, between the polls that were taken for the Herald in March and the polls that were taken for me, twice Tony Blair came up during that time, there was no visible sign, there was no change in your poll rating because of a so-called Blair effect.
Well, with the greatest of respect, well, we expected not to fight it. We fought this campaign, we said we could win. If people in the constituency had wanted a real alternative and something more than a protest, they could have gone for Labour. But the fact is that the issue was the government. They loathe and in many cases hate the government and didn't want the Tory to win. But we fought a good campaign. Yes, Tony Blair came up. Of course Tony Blair should come up. Margaret Thatcher came up to my by-election in 1978, despite the fact that it was in deepest Lanarkshire and the Tory candidate was humiliated, because she believed, as we believe, that you have to fight everywhere in the country because we are going to be the next government of this country, not Alex Salmond.
But this is not natural. This is not natural Labour territory.
No, of course
you didn't.
Not.
You didn't have a local candidate. You did have to parachute in, as indeed, of course, did everybody but Jim Wallace have to parachute in. But
well,
in the sense,
the winning candidate is not going to be a local candidate here either. But she was 2,000 votes behind the Tory at the last election. She was very close, and it's quite clear that people tactically voted. But we fought a strong campaign, and if we come second, let it be said this: if we come second, this will be the first time in post-war election history where a winning party has gone to third place from first place, so it's actually quite important.
Well, it's not actually the first time, but never mind. Labour set to win. This is what Labour were putting through the doors in Perth and Kinross yesterday. Well, they've got the original.
Well, the original's in colour.
Just listen to this before you.
We're going to say Labour set to win.
But this was what Labour was saying yesterday. Now, this must be the most remarkable evaporation.
But this is the party that said free by 93. I mean, people do.
But the point I'm making in this by-election, which is what we're here to talk about, the Tories made a rod for their own back by saying it was a by-election on the constitution. Now they're faced with having to accept the result, or should accept the result. Labour made a rod for their back by hyping up their prospects very little on the ground. And now the Labour result is going to be seen as a substantial defeat.
Let's hear from the man right behind the Labour campaign, Jack McConnell, the General Secretary of the Labour Party, is with Brian Taylor inside the hall in Perth. Brian.
Thanks so much indeed, Kirsty. Yes, indeed, Jack McConnell is with me now. Mr. McConnell, what's this all about, a bundle recount for second and third place? It's unprecedented, surely.
Well, it looks like it's very close, and it looks as if the Conservatives may be asking for a recount. But what we know about tonight are two things. Three things, actually. Firstly, the Scottish Labour Party's had a record increase in the vote ever in a Scottish by-election. Secondly, the Nationalist vote is down on their general election performance in 1992. Percentage is up by minor percentage points, but I think the fact that their vote is down, and they've had less votes tonight than they got in 1992, is an appalling performance for them in this situation. And the Conservatives look as if they've gone from first to third place. I don't want to predict that at the moment because the recount's going to go ahead. If that has happened, it's the first time ever in a Scottish by-election, and that is a shocking result for them. It's been a very good night for Labour.
But Mr. McConnell, I have to put this to you. My understanding is that you were getting your ears bent to no small degree by London over the running of the campaign, and perhaps the position that the party in London perhaps couldn't fully comprehend that when Labour can win Hove, they can't win Perth.
Not at all. We've had an excellent campaign with a united campaign both in Perth, across Scotland, and elsewhere in the UK, with support from our headquarters and from the party leadership.
No tension between Scotland and London?
No, not at all. And I think the party leadership have been absolutely correct to be ambitious about this seat, to support our ambitions for rural Scotland, for new Labour votes, which we've won tonight. We may not have doubled our vote tonight, but we've come very close to it. And that's an outstanding result in a very difficult constituency.
Mr. McConnell, you put out a leaflet saying Labour set to win. Tony Blair used the phrase, victory is within our grasp.
No, he didn't.
Now, he used the phrase, victory is within our grasp. Now, that position is just not going to be demonstrated tonight, is it?
The phrase about victory was used by a Herald reporter, not by Tony Blair. And I think the leaflet Labour set to win was slightly different from the Liberals, which said that they would win, despite the fact that they were always going to come forth.
Yes, sticking to your party. You hyped this up and it hasn't happened.
The publicity has been a big success, the campaign has been a big success. This is a record night for the Scottish Labour Party in a parliamentary by-election, and I'm delighted with that result, and I'm sure the party leadership will be too.
But Mr. McConnell, you hyped this up, and the hype has simply not been delivered. Labour Party hasn't come anywhere near winning. The victors are going to be the Scottish National Party, your sworn enemies in Scotland.
And our campaign has been a big success. We've almost doubled the Labour vote. We've had a record increase in the share of a vote in a parliamentary by-election for the Scottish Labour Party. And we've ensured that the Nationalist vote is less than it was at the general election. The Tories have dropped to third place, they've been humiliated, and Labour's had a very good night indeed.
Okay, thank you very much indeed. Well, with that, we'll take a look at the scenes outside. And there's the various supporters, again, of the SNP, mainly the Nationalists, taking a look at the situation from outside the City Hall.
Thank you very much, Brian. Bill Bush, just picking up on John Major's slender majority, we've got a by-election, Littleborough and Saddleworth. We've got North Down ahead. Critical night for the government.
Well, it is, really. Assuming they lose Littleborough and Saddleworth, which seems very likely, they'd lose just about everywhere in the country, Huntingdon probably, let alone a marginal like Littleborough. By the summer, when Littleborough's out of the way, their majority could be down at 9. And that includes the last remaining whipless rebel, Sir Richard Boddy. If you put him on the opposition side, then they're down at 7. And there's still maybe 2 years to go before the general election takes place. They could easily lose another 3, 4, 5 members of parliament, with more testing by-elections to come. So it's beginning to look a bit frail for them.
And looking at Perth and Kinross as a seat that last time round the Tories had to win and did win, on a repeat of perhaps something like tonight, the kind of seats that they need to hold on to support a majority at Westminster, seats like Stirling, look incredibly fragile.
Well, if the vote collapses in the way that all the indications are, then there's hardly anything in Scotland that would be safe. But by-elections are special events. They are protest votes. They're much more volatile. But it makes things look insecure, at least, for virtually all the Conservative MPs.
Alex Salmond, just picking up on aspects of the campaign, we saw earlier that Michael Forsyth had picked up on Roseanna's republicanism and called her the Republican Rose. That was very much a target during the campaign. But the fact is, she is a Republican, and although that is not party policy, do you think that you could be persuaded of her argument in the coming months at Westminster?
Well, Roseanna, I think, has put forward the view at least 5 times to SNP national councils, and as she says herself, lost each time. I think the interesting thing about her belief in an elected head of state in the election is I don't think it cost her many votes in the constituency, because people, I think, preferred her honesty. And when she was asked a direct question, coming up with a direct answer, and even though the vast majority of people, I think, Perth and Kinross, disagreed with her position, they wanted a candidate for a change who was able to speak the truth. And when she was asked her personal viewpoint, and I think the Tories vastly miscalculated in this campaign of vilification. The record, we had a competition in the SNP backroom as to find the most number of adjectives in any sentence describing our candidate. And we found one sentence in a Tory literature which had 7 pejorative adjectives about our candidate in the space of a single sentence. Now, I think the Tories managed to do, by going way over the top in their negative campaigning, is they actually built Roseanna's character and personality and actually were a substantial asset unknowingly to us throughout the campaign.
It was a particularly hard-line attack on Roseanna Cunningham's republicanism in an area like Perth and Kinross, which, as Alex Salmond says, it would be doubtful that there'd be, you know, a majority of Republicans. It was surprising that it didn't do any damage.
Well, I think, as Bill suggested, that by-elections are strange things. They're not repeated in general elections. People don't actually necessarily vote on a lot of what you say. The whole way through this campaign, we did attempt to put forward government policies.
Real privatisation, VAT and fuel.
Equally, we tried to ensure that the public had the opportunity to get answers from people like the Scottish Nationalists. Because, you know, Alex has not yet actually answered, with regard to separation of Scotland and the rest of the United Kingdom, where he is going to fund this massive deficit, which almost all commentators accept exists, except Alex, who produces a budget or some figures, which even as late as today, I understand, the House of Commons Library has not been given figures as to how he believes he makes up his calculations.
Josh,
he hasn't explained to the electorate of Scotland or the electorate of Perth and Kinross. How he is going to actually balance the books with his policies. Now, that is what we tried to identify as well,
It didn't seem to trouble the voters. And if we actually look at the voting trend in Perth and Kinross in 3 successive general elections and then the local elections this year, the rot had set in. If you look at the Conservative vote there, fairly steady through 1992, through about 40% and down to 23%, and we can now go straight over to the declaration in Perth, and we wait to hear from the returning officer, who will speak in a moment or two. Candidates are now approaching the platform. Great deal of excitement after that short delay over the votes for second and third place. Alex Salmond, this has been a hard-fought campaign by Roseanna Cunningham.
A hard-fought campaign, looks like a very successful one indeed. Let's hope it's a resounding victory.
We wait to hear, you know, she did have a tough campaign, starting with her problems at the beginning over the withdrawal from the candidates list, and one expects that perhaps tonight this will be rather an emotional night for her, given what she went through at the beginning of the campaign.
Yes, I think she'd be entitled to show a bit of emotion. I'm looking forward to hearing her speech. The most difficult thing in politics is to run from the front, and she's done that with grace and style. And I think she deserves every success she's going to have tonight.
George Robertson, Tony Blair said, of course, that Douglas Alexander was a young man who was going to have a bright future in British politics. In a sense, is this campaign about just as much blooding Douglas Alexander for a future campaign?
Well, he fought this campaign and he fought it very well. He's an outstanding candidate and he's got a great future in politics. I'm not taking away from the fact that Roseanna Cunningham, I think, fought a very careful, very clever campaign, and all credit to him. But our campaign, we believe, was fought on the issues, and Douglas Alexander was a star.
The candidate of the mainstream candidates that definitely fought on the issues most, of course, was Veronica Linklater for the Liberal Democrats. In a sense, you know, she was a reluctant politician, but did, it seemed, when I was in the constituency, gather quite a lot of support for what she was saying. But you can't really put such an inexperienced candidate into a by-election, can you, where the focus of attention is so strongly on her and admitted gaffes that she made over policy during the campaign?
Well, why not? I mean, why must Parliament be full of full-time career politicians? I mean, Veronica Linklater, she may not have been in party politics, but she had a lot of experience in things such as social work, or work she'd done in prisons and setting up a school. She could, and she still can, I hope sometime in the future, bring a great expertise to Parliament. I think Parliament would be a better place for people like Veronica Linklater with her experience in it.
When you look at John Godfrey's position in the by-election campaign, do you still say, George Kinross, that he was the best candidate for that area at the time?
Yes, I do. In fact, we leave it clearly to the constituencies to choose a candidate. I saw John Godfrey at work. I went and visited the constituency. I have to say he was very positive, very resolute, and I believe he related very well to the electorate.
But do you think he's a candidate? Do you think he's a candidate who can turn it around at the general election?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I have no doubt about that. In fact, several things are going his way on top of a general trend, I suspect, nearer the election.
Well, let's
look the boundaries are going his way significantly.
Well, let's just take one more look at those voting trends in Perth and Kinross while we have a moment. If you pick up on the Conservatives again through three general elections and the local elections, they stuck fairly squarely at 40%, dropping down there to 23%. If you look at the SNP there, yeah, and they were going up to 37% of the vote there, their highest share of the vote that was in the local elections last month. Liberal Democrats, fairly low there, down to 14%. And finally, Labour. If you look at what Labour's done, they've come up to 19%. And of course, it was their showing in the local elections in last month that led them to believe that perhaps they would do very well in this by-election campaign. George Robertson, do you think that when it comes to looking at what actually went wrong for you in this campaign, you say it was the best post-war result for you, if you know, indeed you had
in Scotland.
Do you think that the issues that Douglas Alexander fought this campaign on were anything like the issues that you'd have to fight on in a general election in this area?
Well, this is a difficult area for Labour. We've never done well in this area before.
But this is Middle Scotland, isn't it?
It's not Middle Scotland at all. There's no way Perth can run.
It's Middle Scotland.
Well, geographically, it's Middle Scotland. But the fact is that here is an area, one of the most prosperous areas in the country, where Labour has never had a great track record. We started off in 12.5%. That's almost deposit losing levels here. If we've got it up over 20%, that is quite a remarkable achievement in the circumstances. We were the third party. And the fact is that the Nationalists were only 2,000 votes behind. The issue, as I say, the issue was only the Tories. The people were saying today, we are going out to stop the Tory winning the seat. And
you just, in a sense, give in to tactical voting in favour of the Nationalists.
No, we're not. We fought this campaign. That's what we didn't do. We fought a serious adult campaign in the constituency here. We put the arguments. And much more worrying is that whether or not Roseanna Cunningham's out of touch on the monarchy. The fact is that in the latest opinion poll, it showed that 55% of Nationalist voters were against independence.
Yes, but against
if you say it was a protest vote,
George Robertson, if I just pick you up on this protest vote business, do you think then that that protest vote is a solid vote in favour of constitutional change, or do you think the people that voted for the Nationalists on a platform of independence will return to the union at a general election?
Well, the worrying thing for the Tory party, I don't know how they're going to vote, but we know consistently people have argued for devolution inside the United Kingdom, and that's what I believe they're asking for. And this is a crisis for the government party. They fought strongly for no change, not just the union. They said no change inside the union, and they are now in crisis as a result of that. And we now know that the most popular option among the electorate in Perth and Kinross, as it is throughout the whole of Scotland, is devolution inside the United Kingdom.
And indeed, George Kine, if we are expecting tomorrow that others in the party will break ranks and call for some kind of constitutional change. Now, if I could just very briefly quote you a very eminent politician in your own party who said that devolution was the only alternative to continued agitation and the breakup of the United Kingdom. But that was said by Alec Douglas-Hume, who represented that seat.
I think what you have to look at is proposals for the government of the United Kingdom and the proposals that are practical. What we have in front of us at the present time are proposals from the Labour Party which involve a tax-raising parliament which will really not work because of the fact that at present we are given in Scotland public expenditure. If you could just let me finish. We enjoy public expenditure in Scotland of some £3 billion more than the rest of the United Kingdom. That conceivably will involve either increased taxation in Scotland. They're talking about threats.
But what if people are prepared to wear that?
Are people really going to be
prepared? But what if the people are prepared to wear that?
When that becomes a real issue, and that that is in fact going to be the government's plank, which is what the Labour Party is wanting to make it, then I believe people will address it. And I believe
you don't think it's a real issue just now?
I believe it's an issue that we have to have a lot of debate over. I believe that from the discussions I've had with business, for example, that they're very concerned, very concerned. And I hope this debate will go on between now and the next general election. It's important that people are aware of the facts. It's important
it's been
that
going
we always
on,
look
it,
at
for 16 years.
Well, I think it's important that we always look at the government of Scotland. I don't think that government is something which doesn't evolve. It does evolve, and we have actually seen some changes.
So, but sorry, can I say you don't
within the Union, within the United Kingdom,
within the United Kingdom, but you don't rule out an assembly.
I'm not ruling anything in or ruling anything
that's
out.
That's right. Oh,
but what
right,
I
just
what, but what I do
moment,
say, what
moment,
I do
I'll come
say
back
is that the assemblies proposed by the Labour Party are clearly
Roseanna,
not
right. Can I just take a break there, because I think at this stage we should go back to the count at Persity Halls and find out what on earth the delay is all about. Brian Taylor.
Kirsty, thanks very much indeed. There has been a bit of a delay, of course, with nine candidates all having to have their votes explained to them. But as I understand it, the candidates and agents have now gone backstage, and we're expecting those candidates to emerge any second now for the declaration in this long-delayed count. The count in the general election, of course, didn't come until 2:21 was the result, but they hope to do a little bit better tonight with a bit more speed and a bit more resources, but they haven't got a lot ahead of that at the end of the day. The expectation is still a Scottish National Party victory, the majority of around about 7,000 that I've been predicting from the beginning of the evening still looks like being just about right. Labour Party is putting a smile on its face. I'm not sure how much of that is genuine and how much of it is enforced, but they do have a smile on their face, because they believe that they will very narrowly snatch second place over the Conservatives, although of course we'll have to see the outcome of that. And the hype and the spin will then go on.
Brian Taylor, at the moment we can see people milling around the front of the stage. Do you have any idea how close we are to some kind of information and declaration?
Kirsty, it's always exciting and tense on these occasions. I would have guessed seconds, because they've all gone backstage to perhaps get themselves freshened up for their appearance before the cameras. But with nine candidates, it's a little bit difficult. There's the pictures outside. They've got no doubt who's won. Roseanna, they say. Indeed, it's been a feature of this by-election campaign that instead of putting Cunningham upon the banners and the posters, they've tried to personalise it still further with Roseanna, perhaps along the lines of the approach taken towards Mrs. Ewing in the... Oh, and here come the candidates onto the stage. Sandy Watson, the Chief Executive of Tayside Regional Council, about to bring us the result.
Ladies and gentlemen, the result of the parliamentary election held in the Perth and Kinross constituency is as follows. Douglas Garvin Alexander, the Scottish Labour Party candidate, 9,620. Gary Douglas Black, Natural Law Party, 54. Roseanna Cunningham, Scottish National Party, 16,931. John Patrick Godfrey, the Scottish Conservative and Unionist candidate, 8,990. Michael Anthony Halford, Scottish Conservative and Unionist candidate, 88. Robin Charles Morton Harper, Scottish Green Party, 223. Vivian Vivian Thornton Lineker, UK Independence Party, 504. Veronica Linklater, Scottish Liberal Democrat, 4,952. Lord David Such, Lord David Such, Official Monster Munch Raving Loony Party, 586. The total number of rejected ballot papers was 25. I therefore declare Roseanna Cunningham of the Scottish National Party to be duly elected.
Here 3 years ago and promised.
Looking there now at that vote in Perth and Kinross, an SNP gain. Looking at the vote there, Roseanna Cunningham, SNP, 16,931. Alexander Labour, 9,620. John Godfrey for Conservatives, 8,990. And Veronica Linklater, the Liberal Democrats, 4,952. The majority there for Roseanna Cunningham was 7,311 and the turnout was 62%. We can look now at the percentage share of the vote. The SNP took 40% of the vote, slightly less than their opinion poll showing. Labour 23%, Conservative 21% and Liberal Democrat 12%. We can look at there now at the change from 1992, SNP up 4%, Labour up 10%, Conservatives down 19% and no change for Liberal Democrats. Now back to Roseanna Cunningham in Perth.
For it's they who have today reopened the door of constitutional opportunity for Scotland and its role in Europe and the world. There's a clear message in this result for the Prime Minister. After 16 long years when the Tory party have politically humiliated Scotland, it's now Scotland's turn to humiliate the Tory party. But there is also a message for all of the unionist parties in Scotland. The days when Scotland could be cheated out of independence by conjuring up a concoction of smears and fears are coming to a close. This result tonight is an assertion of belief in the positive message of change for the better in Scotland and change for good. I want to make a couple more points. I left Scotland at the age of 8 to emigrate to Australia. Every year on my birthday, I made a wish to return to Scotland, and I am glad I came back. I hope not just this victory, but more the manner in which the SNP conducted the campaign makes it clear that ours is a democratic message designed to include all of the people of Scotland, regardless of origin. It is not where you come from as an individual that is important, but where we are going together as part of the community of Scotland. Secondly, I hope that women in Scotland can take particular heart from this result. I want to thank my mother and my grandmother and all the mothers and grandmothers for their struggle to make it possible for me to stand here tonight. That campaign, like this campaign, was not always easy going, but they won, and we have won. What we have here tonight is a resoundingly happy ending. The people of Perth and Kinross have made it clear that they wish to see fresh, strong, female voices playing our part in the debate on Scotland's future. I have a dream of a new Scotland. That dream is shared by the people of Perth and Kinross. Scotland is waking from its slumber. Our dream will come true.
And now Douglas Alexander, the Labour candidate.
Firstly, my congratulations to Roseanna Cunningham. My thanks to the people of Perth and Kinross, and my thanks especially to all my campaign workers and to the Perth and Kinross Labour Party, and also to my agent, Noel Foy, and my campaign manager, Jack McConnell. I am proud of the campaign we have fought over the last few months. We have made an unprecedented effort for putting forward positive policies of the Labour Party. We have taken the fight to rural Scotland, and on tonight's showing, it is the Labour Party that shall win Ayr, Inverness and Stirling at the next general election. This by-election has been dominated by a single issue, a desire to protest against our government, a desire that we in the Labour Party understand. Come the general election, it shall fall to the Labour Party to turn protest into power. My thanks also to the returning officer, to the police and all those who have worked so efficiently at the count tonight. Let no one be in any doubt, our cause is just, the fight goes on.
And now it's the turn of the Conservative, John Godfrey.
Ladies and gentlemen, can I add my thanks to the returning officer and his staff for a very well conducted and efficient count. Can I thank the presiding officers and the counting staff for their work during the day and this evening. The police too for their work around the constituency during the day and officials who brought the boxes in. Can I add a few personal notes of thanks to my agent, Miss Pamela Roberts, to Raymond Robertson MP, and to my wife. Finally, can I thank the almost 9,000 Conservative and Unionist voters of this constituency and the local Conservative and Unionist Association. It has been a pleasure to put the case in this by-election in this time.
Conservative candidate there, John Godfrey. Alex Salmond, first of all, proof that opinion polls can lie. Your highest opinion poll rating in this campaign was 55%. In the end, it was 40%.
Yes, I mean, but I think the opinion polls do underrate the Tory vote, because I think a lot of people are basically ashamed to admit to opinion pollsters that the Conservatives at the present moment. If we compare this vote with last month's vote in the local elections in the constituency, then the SNP vote is up from 36% to 40%. The majority of 7,000 is very satisfactory indeed. I congratulate Roseanna Cunningham on her victory. I think she's, as I say, achieved it with grace and style, and it's a very, very substantial step forward. I particularly liked in her victory speech that she made a particular reference to the position of women in Scottish politics, and now we find a position in the SNP where we've got six elected members, three women, three men. We seem to have achieved a 50-50 balance. I thought that was a point well made in her victory speech. But I think that the key points here are the Conservatives put the Constitution at the heart of the political debate and lost. And George Kynock, who seemed a second ago to be, he's shaking his head now, but before we went to the result, he seemed to be suggesting that there might be now some room for a movement. And secondly, of course, the Labour Party hyped us that they were actually going to win this seat in what Tony Blair described as Middle Scotland. A very substantial SNP victory. I think a step forward, not just for Perth and Kinross, but for the whole of Scotland.
Oh, before we talk a little bit more about Labour hype, first of all, George Kynock, what about the rumour that there may be certain of your number who actually want to drop the word Conservative and make yourself simply the Unionist Party, as to distinguish yourself from other parties and also to distinguish yourself from the Conservative Party, as it were, south of the border?
Well, I'm very content with the name Scottish Conservative and Unionist Party, and I believe that embraces exactly what we are. I think, you know, when we look at this result, if I could just draw it onto that, and hear that the majority of some 7,000, I would like to just take you back to one of the last by-elections of the last Parliament, where, in fact, Kincardine and Deeside, my own seat...
I think your information message page is going off here.
...to silence my bleep. If I could just pull you back to Kincardine and Deeside, because, in fact, there, 5 months before the general election, we lost that seat with a majority of 7,800 against us. 5 months later, I won that seat back with an increased majority of 4,500 compared with 2,000 at the previous general election. By-elections are no way to judge general elections. When we come to the general election, we'll be putting the entire policies of government in front of the electorate, and I believe then we're going to see a true test. But
what did
no
you make of
Vivian
Lineker, the anti-European Union candidate, polling more than 500 votes? Do you think that was significant?
Well, I mean, I do think that in by-elections, people are tending to vote for parties that may occupy a sort of whim for a moment. I really don't believe that in a general election that that candidate would poll anything like that. In a general election, people are going to be asked to judge who is going to be the government for the next 5 years of the country, for the country. And that's when they then tend to polarise their ideas, and that's when we then tend to see the SNP vote drop. I think the SNP should be disappointed tonight because they didn't actually poll as many votes as they polled in the last general election. That's quite a significant figure.
Your poll was down, the poll, George Robertson, was down about 1,000 votes, wasn't it?
The SNP were down 1,000 votes. Yep. Labour was up 3,500. On a reduced poll, the Labour candidate got 3,500 votes more than we got at the general election. This is the best result we've had in a by-election since the war in Scotland.
Well, let's look at that percentage in Perth and Kinross, including tonight's vote there. The three previous general election, then tonight's by-election. Looking at Conservative vote there, down to 21%. SNP, up to 40%. Liberal Democrat, down to 12%. And Labour, as George Robertson said, up to 23%. John Curtis, Professor of Government, who joins us now, what are the extrapolations you would make to further elections and indeed the position of the government after tonight?
I think there are three key messages from this by-election. The first is that the government lost it, the SNP didn't win it. The SNP's vote is actually a little bit down than it was in the October 1974 general election in this constituency. But for the government, the message is quite clear, is that it cannot insulate itself in Scotland from the whirlwind that's affecting it. It's true, George Connick says, by-elections are not like general elections, but if we compare by-elections with by-elections, the Conservative vote is falling twice as heavily in by-elections in this Parliament than it did in the last Parliament. And this result is perfectly in line with all the by-election results in this Parliament so far.
So it's not a case of the Conservatives in Scotland looking themselves, it's central office in London who needs to look a bit beyond.
I think the key message of this by-election for the Conservatives is that talking about the union cannot insulate the Conservatives from the whirlwind that's being reaped by its problems in London. That this does not stop at the border, that Scotland equally, the Conservatives are in trouble if they're in trouble at Westminster. The third key message, however, is for the Labour Party, which is undoubtedly, in many respects, it is a good result. By my records, it's the best result for the Labour Party coming from third in any by-election since 1945. The trouble for them is they talked it up too much beforehand, and as a consequence, they won't reap the benefit tomorrow morning that they otherwise would have done.
We can now have a quick look there at Roseanna Cunningham as she's going through the platform there. We just lost her there. She had a big bunch of yellow flowers in her hand. Picking up on that point about Labour, though, the fact of the matter was that they did pull that result. How would that extrapolate across seats in Britain?
Oh, well, Labour Party clearly, if we extrapolate on these trends, would win a general election tomorrow. But in a sense, that's not news. We've known from the local elections, both north and south of the border, that Labour would win a general election tomorrow. This result is very similar to the result in Eastleigh last year when Labour's vote up went 7%. It essentially suggests that Labour certainly are running somewhere between 45 and 50% across Great Britain as a whole.
But if you look at the actual nature of the vote, what do you say to both George Robertson and indeed George Kinnock that what the SNP were reaping was a protest vote that would return? Is there any evidence that the vote might actually stick this time?
Well, I think the clearest evidence that the vote might stick is that it hasn't risen, particularly in this by-election. Perth is, in fact, is almost the place where the SNP's vote has been strongest, longest. If we go back to the 1950s, they could get a 20% of the vote. This is a long-standing SNP vote.
Well, we can go over now to Perth, where Brian Taylor is with the winner, the new MP for Perth and Kinross, Roseanna Cunningham.
Thanks very much indeed, Kirsty. Thank you very much indeed. And congratulations, first of all, Roseanna Cunningham, on your election victory there. What do you attribute it to mainly?
I think the fact that we kept putting forward the most positive message that we could, and I think the most positive message in this campaign, that we were the party that stood for real change in Perth and Kinross and in Scotland, and I think that's what people responded to.
And yet, each time the SNP has had a by-election gain, it's always gone back at the general election. It's likely to happen again, surely?
Not in Perth and Kinross. We've been building here over a number of years, and this one is definitely going with the tide. This is one we would have taken in a general election, and I think it's one you find we will keep in a general election.
You said in your platform speech there you have a dream for Scotland. Now, it's fine words, but what does that dream involve? What sort of political Scotland do you see? A fairly left-wing one, presumably?
It's a Scotland that people of Scotland want. One which sees decency as the mainstream of what ought to be a government is about, but isn't at the moment. It's Scotland taking its place in the world, not as some grandiose nation looking and harking back to some past glories, but to a real future, a modern future, a future in the 21st century.
Now, you said in your speech also you had humiliated the Conservative Party and particularly the Prime Minister. Do you think your victory here also is perhaps anything in the way of a message to Labour, Labour's attempt to break into the middle ground?
Oh yes, indeed, I think it is. I think that however well they may think their message plays in Middle England, they must learn the lesson that it's not going to play in the same way in mainstream Scotland. And this is mainstream Scotland. Blair came here to tell us that he had the way of it and it was all going to fall to him, and he was so wrong, and he will stay wrong for Scotland.
Do you think you're saying, therefore, the SNP will fight into Labour Party seats? There's no evidence of that whatsoever from the local council elections.
Well, that's not entirely true. We did better in the local council elections than we have done in previous elections. We continue to make gains, slow and steady, step by step, but each time we move forward, we consolidate, and then we move forward from that again.
Finally, how about your Republican views? Did they do you any harm here, and do you intend to pursue them?
No. I've said right at the outset, they were personal views of mine at the election. Clearly took the view that they were not of any real relevance in this campaign, and I hope in a way that this just demystifies that whole argument.
Finally, again, what evidence do you draw of this for a general election outcome in Scotland?
I think you will find the SNP moving forward very successfully in a number of areas, particularly the neighbouring seat of North Tayside, which we now look to win as well. I think it says that the new Labour Party is not going to work outside their present heartland, and we will be fighting them very hard there as well.
Roseanna Cunningham, thank you very much indeed. And to get a flavour of the rest of the night's events, Alan Mackay is outside the hall with four party activists.
And like the four party activists, all the supporters out here are waiting to see Roseanna Cunningham. But before she comes out, Tom Chalmers, where do you go from here now that the euphoria will definitely die down, of course, over the next few weeks?
Well, we go onwards and upwards. We've won a by-election. There's no such thing as an easy by-election. We've proved that the people in Perth and Kinross will vote for a nationalist candidate and for a very strong candidate, and won't vote for a Major clone or a Blair clone. We move onwards from here and carry the argument for independence in Europe forward.
Briefly, where will she stand within the political spectrum of the Scottish National Party?
She'll stand where she's always stood within the political spectrum. She's made no secret of the fact that she's a feminist on the left wing of the party. I don't expect her to change that, and I'm sure that the people in Perth and Kinross don't expect her to change that.
Ian Stevenson, the MP, has said Scotland's humiliated the Tory party.
I don't think so at all. In actual fact, if you look at the results, Miss Cunningham, whilst being congratulated on winning, her vote is actually down from the last time. So the people of Perth have not so much voted in favour. More people have in fact stayed at home. The districts have obviously stayed at home. In the next 2 years we will win them back, and we will win back the seat at the next general election.
Angus Mackay, how do you rate the result from your point of view?
This is a hammering for the Tories. There's no getting away from it. The good news from Labour's point of view is that we've doubled our vote since the last general election to 23%. If you look at the analysis, it means that in the next general election we would take Ayr, Stirling, Inverness, Nairn and Lochaber. A marvellous night for us, a very bad night for the Tories.
Derek Houston, later today Paddy Ashdown makes an announcement about possible pacts. Would that have helped you here?
No, I don't think he's making announcements about possible pacts. What he's stating is that the Liberal Democrats will remain an independent party, and where we are willing to cooperate with other parties, it certainly doesn't mean making any pacts. I don't think the voters on the doorstep, this has been a very major issue. They've been more concerned with issues we've been campaigning on, which is health, education, the railways and law and order.
I have to stop you there. Gentlemen, thank you all. And now we can go back inside the hall where Brian Taylor is with the defeated Conservative candidate.
Thanks, Alan. Thanks very much indeed. John Godfrey, as you say, is with me now. Mr. Godfrey, tell me this and tell me no more. How does it come about that Douce, supposedly Tory Perthshire, rejects you in favour of a left-wing Republican socialist. Surely that seems a big turnover in the voting potential here.
Well, it's a by-election, Brian, and in every by-election there's an element of protest. I think that came through this time in that the turnout was so much lower. I think a number of our people stayed at home rather than transfer their allegiance to another party.
It's not that much lower, surely. It's not that much.
That's 15% lower from the general election result.
Yeah, by-elections are generally lower than the general election position. You're surely not going to blame that as the reason for the outcome.
Well, I'm making the point that I believe a number of people that would normally be Conservative voters stayed at home. I met a lot of people during the course of today in the last couple of days who said exactly that to me, that they would be back for the next general election, but this time they were not coming out, they were abstaining.
Mr. Godfrey, you say this was a protest vote. Exactly what were the voters protesting about in your view? What should the Prime Minister do? What should he change?
Well, I mean, there is always this in the midterm of a government. There is people who perceive some kind of mistake or injustice in government policy. People who, simply because they know the election won't change the shape of the government, decide that there isn't enough time in the day to go and cast a vote.
Would you like to see tax cuts, for example? Do you think that's necessary?
Well, I think when the time is right and the economy is growing properly, continuing to grow properly, then it would be right to cut taxes.
Mr. Godfrey, you fought this election not solely on the union, but very, very dominantly on the issue of defending the union between Scotland and England. It was your ever-present refrain upon the doorsteps. Presumably tonight is a rejection of the union by the voters of Scotland.
No, I don't think it is at all, Brian. I mean, all the evidence that we've seen suggests that about half of the voters who vote nationalist don't themselves agree with independence for Scotland. I don't think it's a rejection of the union at all. I suspect what it is to some extent a rallying of people around one party of protest.
But how could it be the case, Mr. Godfrey, that the party of the union, the union for which you campaigned during the by-election, is suddenly no longer the issue when the result is declared?
Well, I mean, it will remain the issue for my party. And we will go on long after this by-election, emphasising what are the core values, what are the main benefits of the union. I think that message will start to be driven home by my party, whether we're fighting elections or not.
Okay, Mr. Godfrey, just for a moment, I've got Douglas Alexander with me as well. Congratulations, presumably upon second place, although you did say you wouldn't indeed win during the campaign.
The Labour Party that's moving forward tonight. We've had a tremendous result here in Perth and Kinross.
But surely during the campaign you were talking up the prospect, Labour set to win.
We avoided the third party squeeze, we've punched through into second place, and I think we've had a tremendous result tonight.
More generally, what do you think the message tonight for the Conservatives is?
It's a dire message for the Conservatives. It means that seats like Stirling and Ayr are directly in the sights of the Labour Party. On tonight's results, we'll win those seats come the general election.
Yes, but if anyone's delivering a bloody nose to the Prime Minister tonight, it's not your party, it's not Tony Blair, it's the SNP.
We are part of the knockout blow that John Major is suffering just now. The whole of Scotland rejects John Major, and that's why he's suffering in by-elections or in the local elections.
Yes, but it's very much my understanding that Tony Blair's office was looking for more from you, more from the Labour Party in this constituency. It was looking to win. You haven't won.
We've punched through. We've almost doubled our share of the vote. We've seen a massive increase in terms of our share of the vote relative to the last general election. I understand a record showing for the Scottish Labour Party in a by-election. We are delighted. It proves the case that if you come and fight, even in rural areas, you do tremendously well as the Scottish Labour Party.
Mr. Alexander, Mr. Godfrey, thanks very much indeed, and back now to Kirsty in the studio.
And just for a moment, I wish to pursue with George Kinross something he mentioned earlier. Let's just nail this position of the Conservative Party on the union. Earlier on, you said that you didn't rule out a Scottish Assembly.
No, I didn't.
Please amplify that.
No, I didn't. If I did say that, that is not actually what I intended to say. What I said was that government, I believed, should be evolutionary. Now, what I do believe is very firmly in the union of the United Kingdom. Very clearly, proposals for an assembly as put forward by the Labour Party and proposals for independence as put forward by the Scottish Nationalist Party will cost this country and cost this country dearly.
But what about a Northern Ireland type assembly that does not have tax-raising powers?
What I think you have to look at in Northern Ireland is that it's a different situation. Mm-hmm. They don't have the local government structure that we've got. What I believe is that the new single-tier local government authorities that we've got have got a significant amount of local delivery of local government services. I believe we've got to let that bed down and that we've got to make that work. And I believe that people will then see government getting closer to them through this structure. I don't think that is necessary or will work. What I firmly believe is that under the Labour Party's proposals, that we're going to see a diminution of some of the local government responsibilities. The SNP clearly see the responsibilities
of... But there's local government in Northern Ireland.
Clearly see the tax-raising assembly as a stepping stone to independence. They've said it's that, and that is very bad news for Scotland.
Alex
very
Salmon, bad news the latest economy. Poll shows that 70% of the Scottish people do not want independence. Now, can we just be quite clear about your position after tonight? You would take part in the Scottish Parliament, as you would see it, as a stepping stone towards independence.
Yes, well, we'd fight elections for any future Scottish Parliament assembly on would the you, basis George of Kiner? Independence. Sure, but can I just point out to George Kiner that Scotland will only become independent if the people of Scotland vote for independence. There's no way to achieve independence by stealth or sleight of hand. The trouble with George Kinnock is every time the Scottish people say something, whether it's in a general election or a by-election, George Kinnock says, well, we're not going to accept that result, we'll go into the other argument. No, George is spending tonight replaying the arguments for the by-election, which you've lost.
The Nationalists have reduced their vote, so they have not won their argument in this by-election.
George,
that's very clear.
The Liberal Democrat position.
We want to see a Scottish Parliament within the United Kingdom. George Kiner says the SNP haven't won their position tonight because they've reduced their vote. I mean, the Conservative vote is in free fall. And I think it ought to be said that, I mean, people talk about squeeze. We started in fourth position and actually increased our share of the vote. So I think that is something for encouragement. And it does mean in seats like George Kiner's, where we lie in second place, when people are rightly protesting against this government, not just for their policy on not heeding the views of the people of Scotland in terms of our constitution, but their policy on rail privatisation, VAT on fuel, a whole range of policies. People want to protest against this government, and we're certainly Liberal Democrats are challenging. I think tonight's result can give us some cause for encouragement.
And what, George Robertson, do you think of the Blair factor then? It can't win through in Perth and Kinross.
Well, what do you mean didn't win through? We put on 3,400... Well, we didn't win, that's true. But you lost votes, despite your popularity.
We won the election, George.
You can let somebody speak for a moment, Ali. We put on 3,500 votes in a reduced poll. We've doubled our share of the vote in the most unpromising of circumstances.
But you have to do better at the general election, that kind of seat.
Kirsty, if this swing to Labour is replicated in the rest of Scotland, we win Stirling, we win Ayr, and we win Inverness, Nairn and Lochaber. That is a fact. The reality of this is that we were squeezed because the Nationalists were very close behind. This is a good night for Labour. We've had an excellent result here in situations where the Nationalists have not lived up to expectations, and where we have increased the votes that we got and doubled the share that we had at the last election.
But George Kiner, if it's not about the union, your candidate talked about mistakes or injustices that the Conservative voters seem to feel they have been dealt. What are these mistakes and injustices? Are you simply going to offer tax cuts at the next election and hope that buys back the voters of Perth and Kinross?
No, I think what he was referring to is the fact that the media are clearly trying to concentrate the issue on negative issues, whereas there is an awful lot going on in a very positive way for the economy of Scotland and the economy of the United Kingdom. What we've got to do, and clearly there's no room for complacency in this, we have got to try to get our message on the good things through a lot better over the next 2 years. I do believe that the economy is getting better very significantly at the right time. Of course, we want to return as quickly as possible to the policy on tax that we believe in, which is trying to reduce tax. That is obviously going to be a key issue, but the timing is also going to be critical, and we will only do it when it's right.
What will you do, Alex, with an increase in MPs in Westminster?
Well, I think Roseanna Cunningham will add a new dimension to her parliamentary group, but can I just explain to George why he's wrong? The SNP in last year in the Monklands by-election increased our vote by 27%, but it was seen as a failure because we set a target of winning. Labour set a target of winning, and their problem is they've been rejected, just as the Conservatives have been rejected in this constituency.
Indeed, Alex, we must go now and look at, because it is indeed your night, and we can look outside at the pictures there outside Perth City Hall, a young piper there marching up and down the crowds. They're waiting for Roseanna, but we can see all the activists from the various branches of the SNP up and down the country have flooded into the constituency for the last 3 weeks. One thing about the Nationalists, they can manage to get the activists out from north, south, east and west to fight in a by-election. We saw it in Hamilton, we saw it in Govan first time round, and we saw it in Govan again when Jim Sillars won his victory there in 1988. Quickly and finally, George Robertson, your final thoughts on the night.
This is a crisis for the government. The Tory party has halved its share of the vote in its heartland areas. The fact is that this would give us extra...
Quickly now, we can just
Scotland.
Move over just before. I'd like to interrupt you there and say that we can see Roseanna Cunningham coming out now to greet her supporters somewhere in the crowd behind the cameras and the lights. There she is, coming out. Yeah, well, unfortunately, Screaming Lord Such is taking centre stage at the moment, as only he can. Managing to dominate the proceedings, at least for a few moments until his next by-election. Flanked by Wild Willie Beckett with a burnt-out face. Alec.
Well, to continue the argument about Labour's targets in this election, they set themselves a target of winning, and they didn't win. I mean, the problem for Labour Party in Scotland is Tony Blair thinks he can walk in water. Unfortunately, now he's ended up to his neck in the River Tay, and he's got a lot of explaining to do, just as the Conservatives have,
in losing the election. Do you concede that the Labour Party did incredibly well tonight in terms of increasing their actual votes?
That's exactly the point I'm making, Kirsty, is last year the SNP increased its vote in Monklands by 27%, and it was seen as a failure because we set ourselves a target of winning. Labour are in exactly the same position, only increasing the vote by some 10% because they set a target of winning. If you set yourself a target of winning, if you tell people you're going to win, then you must expect to be judged on that particular target.
So the
Tory party is in free fall. Labour haven't achieved their objective, and it's the Scottish National Party who are celebrating tonight.
And here they come now. We can go back over to pictures of jubilation outside Perth and Kinross City Halls. There's the nationalist pour out. There's the new MP for Perth and Kinross, Roseanna Cunningham. Happy now after a difficult start to the campaign. She's won through to take the seat comfortably. Alex Salmond, hard day's work for her tomorrow.
I just realised these are white roses. They're the white roses of Scotland. They're the McDermott poem which smells sharp and sweet and breaks the heart. There's no hearts broken tonight, thank goodness.
That's a display of emotion from you there, Alex.
Well, it's just poetry. I mean, culture. We have to get some culture onto these by-election programmes, Kirsty. These are the white roses of Scotland. So the roses are blooming in Perth and Kinross tonight.
I think it has to be said. Yeah, I think Roseanna Cunningham did very well. She fought a good campaign. But the first campaign she had to win was over the SNP leadership.
And Roseanna Cunningham's going to speak to the crowd.
I couldn't have done it without all of you. So thank you, everybody. You've done it for the party, you've done it for the people of Perth and Kinross, and you've done it for Scotland. Thank you.
Now, Roseanna Cunningham making her way away. Well, George, kind of, how do you think John Major's government will be judged after tonight?
Well, you know, I do believe that the swing against us was the same as in the Kincarn and Deeside by-election. I think it's quite interesting, I repeat, that within 5 months we'd won that seat back with an increased majority. I think
so you think we're going to have a general election in 5 months?
No. I think Roseanna Cunningham has clearly done very well, and I'm very sorry for John Godfrey, who fought a very strong and very positive campaign. But I would say to Roseanna, don't get just too used to Parliament, because I think you're going to find your stay there is relatively short.
John Curtis, do you think Roseanna Cunningham would do well not to get too used to Parliament?
Maybe she shouldn't get too used to Parliament, but equally let's bear in mind that the last time that the Conservative vote fell this heavily in a by-election was in 1962, and the Conservative Party did lose the ensuing general election.
There you are, George, kind of not cool comfort there.
Well, I think that we've still got the best part of 2 years until the general election, and I think we've got a lot of time to show that almost all of our policies are going really very well. We've got to make sure we get that message across, and then I believe that the electorate will judge us at that time, at the end of the term.
Well, the current majority is now in single figures, so whether the timing of the election is entirely in either George Kinnock or John Major's hand, I'm not altogether sure. But tonight, I think, has been a victory for positive politics against negative campaigning, and I think that's good not just for Perth and Kinross, I think that's good for Scottish politics.
Gentlemen, thank you very much indeed. I'm afraid that is all we have time for from tonight's by-election special from Perth and Kinross. We welcome in the new SNP MP, Roseanna Cunningham. From all of us here, good night.